dun 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 dun.
What are you up to now?
Professor, you startled me. How did you know it was me?
Oh, I don't know. Maybe your gavel handle gave you away?
Every time.
Are you pretending to be someone else?
Yes, I wanted to feel what it's like to be a spy.
Oh, how come?
Well, I've been learning a lot about espionage. That spy talk for, well, being a spy.
Oh, got it.
Seems like a fun job.
Are you looking for a new line of work?
I like to keep my options open.
Okay, well, before you get too far into this whole spy thing, can I tell you something?
Sure, but keep it on the down low. This location may not be secure. You could have been followed.
Are you done?
Almost. Who sent you?
Stryker, it's me, your boss.
Right, right. Sorry, continue, Professor. That is your real name, right?
Oh, brother. Being a spy or a secret agent can be very dangerous.
It can?
Yes. Take, for example, the story of Ethel and Julius Rosenberg, who were killed for being spies in the 1950s.
Killed?
Executed by the government.
Yipes! Maybe I should look into this possible career a little more carefully. Can you tell me a little more about the Rosenbergs and why they were executed?
I thought you'd never ask. It was November 1944, and Ethel and Julius Rosenberg were visiting with family in their New York City home. According to David Greenglass, Ethel's brother, Ethel approached her sister-in-law Ruth that night. Ethel asked Ruth to recruit David, who was working in New Mexico for the government at the time, to steal secret information about the atomic bomb.
Why would she do that?
Ethel and Julius were supposedly working as spies for the Soviet Union.
I see.
The Soviet Union was falling behind in the race to develop advanced weaponry. It was the start of the Cold War, and the Russians were very interested in what America was building.
So, what did David do?
Well, reluctantly, David agreed. He showed up in New York City 2 months later with handwritten materials which he gave to Julius Rosenberg, along with a list of scientists from his work he thought might be sympathetic to communism.
Oh boy, that's treason, isn't it?
No, it sure is. As President Dwight Eisenhower later stated regarding the execution,
these two individuals have been tried and convicted of a most serious crime against the people of the United States. They have been found guilty of conspiring with the intent and reason to believe that it would be to the advantage of a foreign power to deliver to the agents of that foreign power certain highly secret atomic information relating to the national defense of the United States. The nature of the crime for which they have been found guilty involves the deliberate betrayal of the entire nation and could very well result in the death of many, many thousands of innocent citizens. By their act, these two individuals have, in fact, betrayed the cause of freedom for which free men are fighting and dying at this very hour.
Wow, that's powerful. I guess being a spy might only be cool if you were working for the right team.
What do you mean?
I would like to help our government, not hurt it.
Oh, I see. Well, speaking of helping our government, would you like to hear how the government obtained their evidence against the Rosenbergs?
Sure.
Okay. It's a little confusing, so bear with me.
Okay.
After the U.S. government realized the Soviets were quickly developing nuclear weapons, they began to investigate.
Through secret agents of our own?
Yes.
Cool.
And they discovered that a German refugee physicist named Fuchs had given key documents to the Soviets. Fuchs then named Harry Gold, who he said was his carrier pigeon. Gold confessed, but identified David Greenglass as an additional source.
Oh, Greenglass. I remember him. Ethel's brother.
Right. Greenglass was soon arrested and confessed too, but he said he was recruited by his brother-in-law Julius, who asked his wife Ethel to talk to David through his wife Ruth.
Gotcha.
Oh, good. I'm glad you're keeping this all straight.
Must be the spy in me.
There were others involved too, but we'll stop there with our list.
Okay, but if there were others involved, why were the Rosenbergs the only ones executed?
Because the Rosenbergs were the only ones who didn't implicate anyone.
What? You mean they didn't talk?
Exactly. Throughout the trial, both Ethel and Julius asserted their right under the Fifth Amendment to remain silent when asked about their involvement in the Communist Party or their knowledge of others involved in the theft of atomic secrets. This came at a time when America was highly suspicious of everyone and heavily involved in outing communists everywhere.
So the Rosenbergs may have been framed, caught in the crossfire, hunted like the witches of Salem?
Perhaps. Listen to this. When the grand jury met to decide whether or not to indict the Rosenbergs, the chairman of the Atomic Energy Commission stated,
"It looks as though Rosenberg is the kingpin of a very large ring. And if there's any way of breaking him by having the shadow of a death penalty over him, we want to do it."
The prosecution needed Ethel to be convicted too. So reportedly, just 10 days before the start of the trial, they persuaded David and Ruth Greenglass to turn on their own flesh and blood and alter their previously made statements.
How so?
In his first interview, David Greenglass stated that he had passed the atomic data he collected to Julius on a New York street corner. However, when he was re-interviewed, he changed his story to implicate Ethel. He now claimed that he had given Julius the information in his home and that Ethel had taken his notes and retyped them for Julius.
He turned in his own sister?
Apparently. But as a result of his altered testimony, all charges against his wife, Ruth, were dropped.
That's nice. But turning on your own sister?
David later admitted in an interview that to spare his wife, he testified that his sister typed the notes.
"I frankly think my wife did the typing, but I don't remember. My wife is more important to me than my sister, or my mother, or my father, okay? And she was the mother of my children."
That's cold. So the Rosenbergs were convicted and executed, right?
Yes, but not without a vocal campaign for clemency.
Clemency?
It's when the president intervenes and lessens someone's sentence. In this case, he could have stayed the execution.
Oh.
And many people, including Pope Pius XII and Pablo Picasso, asked President Eisenhower to spare the couple's lives.
"The courts have provided every opportunity for the submission of evidence. In this time-honored tradition of American justice, a freely selected jury of their fellow citizens considered the evidence in this case and rendered its judgment. It is my duty, in the interest of the people of the United States, not to set aside the verdict of their representatives."
So Ethel and Julius were executed by electric chair on June 19, 1953.
Who were they?
The Rosenbergs' two sons, Michael and Robert.
What happened to them?
Well, they were adopted by a Jewish couple in New York City, Anne and Abel Mirapol. Strangely enough, Abel was already famous in his own right.
Why? Was he a spy too?
Oh no, nothing like that. After seeing this photograph of a lynching in Indiana, he wrote a song called Strange Fruit, which was recorded by Billie Holiday, who was considered by many to be the greatest jazz vocalist of all time.
"Southern trees bear a strange fruit."
Huh. It really is a small world, isn't it?
That it is. In fact, the Rosenberg brothers petitioned none other than President Obama in 2015 to exonerate their mother. They acknowledge their father's guilt, but believe Ethel was framed. However, she never received the exoneration they requested.
Hard to know who's telling the truth.
Sometimes it is. Is there another case you'd like to learn the truth about?